evening, as we dwell upon the Word of God, we are going to look at how faithful God is. No matter what, He is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. He is a God who never changes. Our situations may change. We may go through a difficult path. Our journey may be tough at times. It may not be easy always. The path that God takes us through may be difficult at times. It may not be easy always. No matter what, the power of God doesn't change. The love of God doesn't change. The sovereignty of God doesn't change. He is the promise keeper. He is the promise keeper of our lives. Amen. So we're going to move on. And there are four things I want to highlight. From the different men and women of God in the scriptures. We need to believe that God is the God who keeps His promises. We need to believe that He is the one who is the promise keeper. But most of the times, we fail to understand. We fail miserably to acknowledge God in our lives. So the first thing is, we need to acknowledge Him and walk close with God. We need to acknowledge Him and walk close with God. When we doubt His sovereignty, one of the things that tends to happen always is we fail to acknowledge God. But one thing that we need to understand is our God is a God who is faithful. Amen. Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse 60 says, "Yet I will remember the covenant I made with you in your youth, and I will establish an everlasting covenant with you." Our God is a God who will establish an everlasting covenant with us. And He not only establishes the covenant, but He is also faithful to remember the covenant and the promises that He establishes in our lives. And 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 13. If you have your Bibles with you, you can turn your Bibles with me and read through the scriptures. "If we are faithless, He remains faithful, for He cannot disown Himself." We may be faithless at times, most of the times, but our God is a God who is always faithful, so we can always count on Him. Amen. We can always count on Him because He is a God who is faithful. In Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 9, we read, "Know therefore that the Lord your God is good. Know therefore that the Lord your God is good. He is the faithful God, keeping His covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love Him and keep His commands." So His covenants remain not only with our generation, but our generations to follow. That's how faithful our God is. Amen. So we'll move on as we read from the scriptures. When God makes a promise, it will be accomplished through His sovereignty. When God makes a promise, He will definitely accomplish it through His sovereignty. There may be times we may not be able to understand His ways. We may not be able to understand the plans that God has for our lives, but definitely God will accomplish every promise, every covenant through His sovereignty. And in Numbers chapter 23 and verse 19, we read that God is not a man that He should lie. God is not a man that He should lie. He is a God who never lies. You don't have to doubt Him at all. He is a God who will never lie. He will never ever fail us. He will never ever leave us, neither forsake us, because He is a God who never lies. And in Psalm chapter 145, verse 13, we see that the Lord is faithful to all His promises. If He has made a promise, He is faithful enough to fulfill that. He is faithful enough to accomplish that in our lives. So God keeps His promises. Are you with me this evening? Amen. He is the God who keeps His promises, and He is the promise keeper. So the first thing that we need to do is acknowledge Him and walk close with God. So I want to highlight a few things from the life of Mary, who is the mother of Jesus. Luke chapter 1, verse 46 to verse 55. So if you can open up the Bible and go through with me, Luke chapter 1, verse 46 to 55. I'm going to just highlight a few scriptures from this passage. As we read through this passage, we would understand that how Mary knew her God. Today, if I ask you a question, how many of us will be able to say that I know my God very well? I know my God very well. I know His heart. How many of us will be able to say that genuinely, that I really know my God? I know His heart. I know His mind. But as you go through this story, as you read through this passage, when you see the statements that Mary makes, you would understand that Mary knew her God very well. In verse 47, we see that she acknowledges God as her Savior. So she knew very clearly that God was her Savior. She didn't have any doubt in that. She knew that God was her Savior. And in verse 48, she says that God who is mindful. So she knew that God is a God who is mindful of her. And as we move on, in verse 49, we see that she acknowledges God's goodness. So she knew that God is a God who is good. She knew that God is a God who is faithful. And as we read verse 50, His mercy extends to those who fear Him. So she knew that God is a God who is merciful. She knew that the mercy of God extends to everyone who would fear Him. She understood God's mercy and grace upon Abraham and his children. She knew the scriptures. In verse 54 and 55, we read that she quotes verses from the scriptures. She quotes verses from the book of Psalms. So this quotes, and this makes us understand that she knew the scriptures very well. The scriptures were actually deep down in her heart. She was able to memorize the scriptures. She was able to quote the scriptures, and the word of God was very close to her heart. She understood the big picture of God's plan for her life. She understood God's plan of choosing an ordinary girl like her to have the Messiah be born into this world. Amen. That was the life of Mary. She had a close walk with her God. She had a close walk with her Savior. She knew who her God was. And that's why the situations that she had to go through in her life didn't shake her, didn't move her, because she knew the plans and purposes that God had for her life. She knew the promises God had for her life. When she heard the news from the angel, she was able to take it in the right way because she understood the big picture. She understood the plan that God had for her life. In Matthew chapter 2 and verse 11, we read that God fulfilled what He promised in Mary's life. But did Mary rebel? Did Mary go against God? No. She just totally agreed and accepted what she heard, what she saw, because she knew who her God was. She completely trusted God. And the Savior Jesus was born through her. Amen. That was the life of Mary. She acknowledged God in everything. She acknowledged Him in every situation of her life. And she had this close walk with God. Today, if we can think of our lives, when something doesn't come to pass in our lives, how do we respond? How do we react? The first thing that we tend to do is we tend to question, we tend to doubt, we tend to move away from God. We fail to acknowledge the good things that He has done for us. When we go through pain, when we go through suffering, the first thing that we tend to do is we fail to acknowledge God. But no matter what, He is our Creator. He will be our Creator. No matter what, He is our Heavenly Father. He was our Heavenly Father. He is our Heavenly Father, and He will always remain our Heavenly Father. I just want to share one experience that I went through a few years back in my life. I had to go through a surgery. I think it was 10 years back, but it was a very painful surgery. So the first thing the doctor said is, we're going to try out with laparoscopy first. And if we are not able to remove this cyst, we would have to open the abdomen. So that was the procedure. If they're not able to do it through lapro, they would try it out first and then they would have to go to the next procedure. So we said, okay. And we said, okay, God, please take care of everything. And we just went to the hospital and everything was done and the procedure was on. And they started with the lapro. As the doctors doubted, they were not able to complete the surgery with lapro. And then they had to cut open the abdomen and the procedure was over. And then I was out of these operation theater. I was in the post ward. Within few minutes, the pain was unbearable because the anesthesia effect had fully gone out of my body. I was fully out of sedation. I don't know what went wrong. Maybe the anesthetist gave me the anesthesia only for the lapro, and I think he forgot to give me for the next surgery. So within few minutes, the sedation was fully gone. I was just suffering with unbearable pain. So because of the pain, which was very severe, I went breathless. I was not able to breathe properly, and I thought that was the last day of my life. The first thing that came to my mind was, God, why do I have to go through this pain? Why do I have to go through this suffering? Why don't you take my life now? I felt that was the last day of my life because of my breathlessness and that unbearable pain of surgery. But immediately there was this second question that just overtook this experience of mine. The second thought that just came into my mind was, Jesus died for you on the cross. He had to go through so much of pain for you on the cross for no reason. He didn't do any sin. He died for us because He loved us so much. This came into my mind, and this was something that God reminded me, that He loved me so much that He went through that pain on the cross several thousand years ago. And this pain that you are going through right now, I will give you the strength to overcome, and you will live. You will not die. So that was a hope that came because God made me understand that He loved me so much. For a minute, I thought, God, maybe you should take my life. And then the next thing that God reminded me was, I love you so much. Even if you go through struggles and pain and trials in this world, I will give you the strength to overcome. But just you have to acknowledge me. From that day on, I decided, God, no matter what, how much of a tough or difficult situation, it may be physical sickness or health, or it may be an issue in the family, or it may be an issue in the church or in the community or with your children, no matter what, I would not question you hereafter. I would not doubt you hereafter. I made a decision that day that, God, no matter what, I will always acknowledge you because I know who you are to me. I know that you are a God who loves me. If I go through a pain, that doesn't mean that you don't love me. Amen. And God is the God who has always been faithful, and He is faithful till today. Amen. And the second thing I want to highlight is He keeps promises. So be humble and choose to be blameless. He keeps promises. So always be humble and blameless. So we're going to go through the life of Noah and understand this. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5 to 8. Verse 5 says, the Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. God determined to wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. So here we read that Noah was a man who lived a blameless life. He lived a righteous life, and so he found favor in the eyes of Lord. And again, we'll move on and look from the life of Mary, Luke chapter 1 and verse 30. Mary was blameless. She was a virgin. She found God's favor. There are times when I have thought that God chose Mary. Maybe many of you would have thought, why did God choose Mary to be the mother of Jesus? We don't have an answer to that. But few things that we can learn from Mary's life is she was a person who had a close walk with God. As we saw through from the scriptures, she had a good relationship with God. She knew who her God was. She was a person who loved God so much, who loved His word so much, who memorized His word. It was there always in her heart, and she lived a life which was blameless, and she found favor in the eyes of God. Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 2 says, a good man finds favor. So if you find favor, I think God has seen something good in your life. Amen. Psalm chapter 84 and verse 11 we read, God bestows favor and honor. No good things does He withhold from whose walk is blameless. No good things does He withhold from whose walk is blameless. So if your walk is blameless before God, if your walk is righteous before His eyes, He will not withhold. He will not withhold any good thing from your life, and you will find favor in the eyes of God. So the second thing that God wants us to remember is, as He keeps His promises, He wants us to live that blameless and humble life. One of the things that tends to happen always in our lives is we tend to get into every wrong attitude and sin of our lives when we fail to see the favor of God in our lives. Sometimes we expect favor at our workplace, and maybe we didn't see that favor. Maybe we expected a blessing from God during a particular time, during a particular season, and maybe we were not able to see that. The first thing that we tend to do is we actually mess up our life. We mess up the relationship that we hold with Christ. But God wants us to assure this morning that He is a God who will keep His promises no matter what. But the one thing that He wants us to do is to be humble, to be blameless. Don't give up on your righteous life. Don't give up on your holy life, because that's the first thing that we tend to give up. Why should I live a holy life? I've been living this holy life for years. I've been living this righteous life for years, but yet I have to go through many struggles in my life. I have to go through many struggles at my workplace. So why do I have to actually live this holy life is something that we always question God for, and we tend to fall in the pit. We tend to fall in the trap of the enemy. But this morning God is saying, I will keep my promises. I want you to be humble. I want you to be blameless. Amen. The third thing that God is reminding us is He keeps our promises, and He wants us to surrender. He keeps His promises, but He wants us to surrender. Again, we are going to go and look into the life of Mary. She surrendered to God's will. Luke chapter 1 and verse 38, we read that she surrendered to God's will. What happened to Mary was not ordinary. It was extraordinary. What happened to Mary was not natural. It was supernatural. People would not accept what happened to her. She was conceived with the help of the Holy Spirit. She was a person who was engaged to Joseph. And as a woman, maybe she would have had several dreams and desires about her marriage. She would have had several dreams and desires about her wedding day. She would have had many things in mind. But the minute this message came to her, she was the person who was willing to surrender. She didn't say, God, I'm engaged to Joseph. You can't do this to me. I have my plans. I have a lot of things in my mind. I have to make sure that this marriage happens. I have to make sure that I see this day. I cannot accept this. She didn't actually argue with God. In fact, she inquired because it was not natural for her to be conceived by the Holy Spirit, being a virgin. But she inquired with the angel of the Lord and she got clarity of all her questions. And when the angel explained it to her, she was willing to surrender. She was willing to accept what God had planned for her life. She was willing to accept the promise that God gave her to bring forth the Messiah into this world. So such was the life of Mary. Today, God expects such kind of a life from our lives too. Maybe we want to proceed with certain things in our lives only when we get to hear from God. Many things we don't get clarity. Sometimes we really doubt so many things. We question God. We wait on Him. We pray. There is nothing wrong in waiting on God and asking God for a clarity. But when we are willing to surrender, God will come through. But if we are not willing to surrender, we actually fail in our relationship and in understanding God in and through our lives. So this morning, I want to remind each and every one of us here this evening that He is a God who keeps His promises, but He wants us to surrender. He wants us to totally, completely surrender. Sometimes it's easy to surrender when everything is clear, when everything is so clear, when the door is fully open, when the path is fully straight, when the path is full of light, it's easy to surrender. But when there is darkness, when we are not able to see through that door, when we are not able to see through that path, it's not easy to surrender. But this morning, God is promising that I am the promise keeper. I will keep the promises that I have made with you, no matter what. But I want you to surrender. Amen. So this morning, can we just give our lives into His hands and say, God, I surrender. And when we surrender, He will fulfill and accomplish all the promises that He has for us. And you see the life of Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. Abraham surrendered to God's will. Here we saw Mary who surrendered totally to God's will. And here we see Abraham who surrendered totally to God's will. When you go through the scriptures in the book of Genesis chapter 12, you can read entire story of Abraham, the way God called him, the way God said, you have to leave everything and come back. You have to follow me. I will show you the place where you need to be going. So here we see that God called Abraham and He promises a nation to Abraham. God established a covenant with him that He will make him into a great nation. God said that I will make you into a great nation and other nations will also be blessed through your descendants. That was the promise that God makes with Abraham. That was the covenant that God made with Abraham. And next God says, Abraham, you have to leave your country. You have to leave your country, you have to leave your people, you have to leave your father's household and go to the land where I am showing you. So he had no clue of where God was calling him to go. He had no clue of what God was trying to show him. He didn't have any idea, but he totally surrendered. We see the life of Abraham. He totally surrendered to what God had promised him because he had trust in God. Sometimes surrendering to God becomes difficult when we actually don't trust Him. But if we really trust Him with all our heart, we will be able to totally surrender. Even when we are not able to see through things, even when we are not able to have a clarity about what's happening in our lives, we may not be able to see the future. We may not be able to see what lies ahead of us. But when you completely trust God, you will be able to surrender. And that's how Abraham totally surrenders because he knew who his God was. He knew that he could trust his God completely. He didn't have an idea of where God was taking him, but he knew that God definitely knew where God was calling him to go. And so we see Abraham completely surrendered into God's hand. And we see that the scripture says Abraham was called the father of nations. God promised him that he would make him a great nation. And God fulfilled that promise in Abraham's life. But when God started to work in Abraham's life, there was no clue of how things were going to work. There was no clue of how things would happen and fall in place. But Abraham just surrendered, completely trusting God. And God fulfilled the promises in Abraham's life. Fourthly, we're going to see that God keeps his promises in his perfect timing. So be patient and trust him. So as we are highlighting that God is a God who keeps his promises, he is the promise keeper. One thing that we need to always remind ourselves is that he is perfect with his timing, but we need to be patient and trust him fully. This is something that we always lack. This has always been a challenge in most of our lives because we always teach God about timings. We always teach him about seasons for our lives. We always say, God, I think this is the time that you should have done this in my life. Maybe this is the season where I should have got married. Maybe this is the season where I should have brought forth a child into this world. There may be many things that you would have dreamed and desired about your life, about your family, about your future, about your work, about maybe your education, your college, your studies. Many things would have come to your mind. But most of the times we teach God about time and seasons for our lives. But remember that he is a God who is faithful. He keeps his promises. He wants us to be patient and he wants us to wait for his time for our lives. We're going to look through the life of Elizabeth and Zechariah. Luke chapter 1 verse 13 to 17. Luke chapter 1 verse 13 to 17. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John." In Luke chapter 7 and verse 28 we read, "I tell you, among those born of women, there is no one greater than John. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he." Zechariah and Elizabeth, they were praying for a child. They were praying. But God didn't choose to answer them immediately. It wasn't because God didn't hear their prayers. Of course, God heard their prayers. Of course, God wanted to answer them, but there was a delay. It didn't happen as they expected it to happen. There was a delay. It was because God had something much more greater than what they had planned for their life. And that we see when John was born into their lives. Amen. God had greater plan and purposes through this child, John, who prepared the way for Jesus. And such is the blessing that God will bring into our lives if we choose to wait on him patiently. But that is the toughest thing that we can experience in our lives. To wait on God, to completely trust him, and to be patient is something which is not easy. But here we see the life of Zechariah, that he waited. They prayed and they didn't give up on praying. They kept praying. They prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. But one day, God answered. The plan that God had for them to bless them with John didn't just pop up suddenly. He already had that plan, but they didn't understand that. Maybe they couldn't understand at that point of time, but they kept praying and God answered their prayer in his perfect timing and the plan and purpose that God had in their lives by blessing them with this child was fulfilled. Amen. Same way, God wants each one of us to wait on him, to completely trust in him, patiently wait on him, and we will see the way God's promises will be fulfilled in our lives too. When we see the life of Mary again, Luke chapter 1 and verse 34, we see and we read that Mary believed. We see that Mary believed. She was a person with faith. When the angel spoke to Mary about the Messiah, she did not doubt it. She only inquired about it, as it was not natural to conceive being a virgin. So she had this complete trust and faith in Christ. If we have to patiently wait on Him, we need to completely have this faith in God. Because if we don't have this faith, we will not be able to wait patiently. Because faith is something that you have not seen. Things that you believe which are unseen. If you completely have this faith on God, no matter what, you will be able to believe. But if you doubt, you will not be able to wait on God at all. But if you completely have this faith on God, no matter things don't happen the way you want it to be, but if you completely have this faith on God, you will be able to wait on God. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6 we read, "And without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him." So without faith it is impossible to please God. So God expects us to be faithful. He expects us to have that faith in Him, because if we lose our faith, we actually lose Christ. We believe in him, we believe in His holy name, we believe in His matchless name only by the faith that we have in Christ. If we lose this faith, we lose God. So without faith, it is impossible to trust God. So God is reminding us that I will keep my promises, but I want you to have this faith in me. So trust me fully, wait on me, and be patient with me. Amen. So these are the worldly promises that we saw in through the scriptures, through the lives of different people on this world. There are a lot of promises that God promises us to be fulfilled and to be accomplished in this world. But there is the greatest promise that God has given to each and every one of us, which is the promise of everlasting life. God will, of course, fulfill every plan and purpose that He has for us in this world to accomplish, in this earth to be fulfilled, because He has always established covenants and promises with men and women of God, and He has been always faithful in fulfilling those promises and covenants that He has made. But He is a God who has made this greatest promise with you and me. He has made this greatest promise with each and every one of us who believe in Him, which is the promise of the everlasting life. It is the promise of the eternal life. In John chapter 3 and verse 16, we see that His greatest promise is anyone who believes in Him, anyone who believes in Jesus, will receive this everlasting life. The Father sent His only Son for each and every one of us to die for us, so that we would have this eternal life, so that we would experience this eternal life with Christ in heaven. And as we move on, John chapter 5 and verse 24, we see that whoever believes in Him receives this eternal life. The only thing that God wants us to do is to believe. But if we fail to believe, we lose it all. He wants us to believe in Him. And as we believe in Him, we also receive the promise of eternal life with Christ. And chapter 6, verse 47 says that one who believes has eternal life. So this is a promise that God has already made to each and every one of us. If you believe, you already have this eternal life. And chapter 6 and verse 48, we read that He says that I am the bread of life. He is our life. He is our hope. He is our faith. But the only thing that we need to do is believe. And if you and I believe, we have this greatest promise of everlasting life being fulfilled in each one of our lives. We don't have to worry about what is happening with us right now. We don't have to fear of what lies ahead of us. We don't have to be worried about our past, because we have a hope and a future in Christ. The God who has promised us is faithful enough to give us this eternal life if we believe in Him.